Good morning, Gateway. My name is Andre. I serve on the Gateway Central Arts team, and we're so glad you're spending some of your Sunday morning with us. At Gateway, we invite you to come as you are. Our motto here is no perfect people allowed. So in fact, if you've been coming as you are for a little while now, we invite you to invite a friend, a family member, a coworker. You can do that really quickly by clicking next to the screen here. Now, wherever you are in your spiritual journey, whether you've been coming to Gateway for a while, you've been a believer your whole life, or maybe you're just checking faith out, kind of just seeing how we do things. We invite you to get rid of all the distractions. Put your phone on Do Not Disturb or put it out of sight, unless you're watching this on your phone, and then maybe don't do that. But we're gonna start our service by connecting our hearts and minds to God through music. Now, for some of us, this is an opportunity to sing out in praise and gratitude to a God we believe to be really faithful. For some of us, maybe just exploring faith, this is an opportunity to sing these songs as a prayer and a hope, really, that God will continue to show himself in our lives in new ways. And if you're just checking faith out, maybe just reflect on these lyrics or sing them out, whatever suits you. But we're so glad that you're joining us here this Sunday morning. Let's sing out together.
My dreams and words, my heart is yours forever, my plans in the sky. You want my heart, you got it, you got it, you got it. If you want my heart, you got it, you got it, you got it. If you want my heart, you got it, you got it, you got it. If you want my heart, you got it, you got it, you got it. If you want my heart, you got it, you got it, you got it. If you want my heart, you got it, you got it, you got it. If you want my heart, you got it, you got it, you got it. If you want my heart.
Hey guys, my name is Jenny Green, if we've never met. As we continue in this time of worship and singing, this next song may be new to some of us. It's called Defender. I know for myself, I was introduced to this song about a year ago, and it was one of the hardest times I've ever had to face, where mentally and physically, I really didn't know how I was going to make it through. I couldn't will my way out of it. I couldn't fix it. I couldn't change it. And I know for so many of us right now, that's exactly what we're experiencing. We can't change the circumstances we're in. We can't wish it gone. But we're powerless. But the one thing that I've learned is that God is our defender, and that He fights for us, that He goes before us, and that all we have to do is just be still. So during this next song, I just encourage you to just let that sink in, to let that wash over you, to reflect on that. That He is the one that fights our battles.
You go before I know that you've even gone to win my war. Your love becomes my greatest defense. It leads me from the dry wilderness. You go before I know that you've even gone to win my war. Your love becomes my greatest defense. It leads me from the dry wilderness. Oh, I did what is praise.
So much better this way.
peace put me back together. You are the defender of my heart.
God of creation, there at the start, before the beginning of time. With no point of reference, you spoke to the dark and fleshed out the wonder of life. And as you speak, 100 billion galaxies are born. The paper of your breath, the planets born. The stars were made to worship, so alive. I could see your heart in everything you made. Every burning star, a signal fire of grace. Creation sings your praises so loud. God of the promise, don't speak in vain, no syllable empty or. You have spoken on nature and science, follow the sound of your voice. Let you speak. A heart of caring creatures catch your breath. Involving in the pursuit of what you. Within our reveals your nature so alive. I can see your heart in everything you say. Every painted sky, a canvas of your grace. Creation still obeys you so alive. So the stars were made to worship so well. Mountains bear your memory so high. The oceans roar your praises so alive. For if everything exists to lift you high, so alive. If the wind goes where you sing it so alive. The rocks cry out in silence, so alive. The sun of our praises still fall shy. We'll sing again 100 billion times. God of salvation, chased down my heart through all of my fear. What a hell you created, light of the world, abandoned in darkness to die. And as you speak, 100 billion failures disappear. Where you lost your life so I could find it. If you left the grave behind you so I could see your heart in everything you've done. Every part designed in the work of art. You gladly chose surrender, so will I. I see your heart a million different ways. Every precious one a child you died to save. If you gave your life to love and serve. Like you would again 100 billion times. Oh, what measure could amount to your tears? If the one who never leaves the one
is Harmony, and I work at Gateway Pflugerville with the kids in the Reconciliation and Justice Network, and I'm coming to you from downtown Pflugerville today. But wherever you are, whether you are in your living room on your couch, whether you are here in Pflugerville with me, Austin, or beyond, I would just like to say welcome, and I am so glad you're here. At Gateway, we want to be an authentic community where you can connect and where everybody belongs. So I would love for you to connect with us, whether you're in Pflugerville with me, or South Austin, Central Austin, North Austin, Buda, or Dripping Springs.
Hey, it's Paul. If you're new to Gateway, would you introduce yourself to us? The easiest way to get connected is to go online at gatewaychurch.com and click on Get Connected. Let us know where you're watching from, and if you live in Austin or the surrounding areas, we'd like to give you a free copy of Not Like Me, a book about loving, serving, and influencing others in our divided world. It's a book written by one of our pastors on staff, and it's a great book during these pressing times.
Hey, it's John Ng here. You may be wondering how you can give help during this season. In part, that's why we receive our weekly offering. And if you're new here, please feel no obligation whatsoever to give. But if you feel like giving out of a heart of generosity, then we want to encourage you to go to gatewaychurch.com, click Give Help. Your giving has already made a tremendous impact during this pandemic season. In fact, we fed hundreds of people through our food pantries, including our partners here in Pflugerville. So thank you for making an impact, making a difference. As we continue to serve and bring life and freedom to every people group we touch, both here in Austin, the metro area, to our global partners and around the world. Thank you again for being a part of this initiative, and we are so grateful for your generosity. It makes more of a difference than you may ever know.
Speaking of life and freedom, next week we'll actually be hearing from Danielle and Rob Koch as they share their story about addiction and how they found life and freedom in Jesus. If you've experienced addiction, you know someone who has, or you want to love and walk alongside those who do, we encourage you to join us and invite your friends and family. Well, this week we're going to be continuing in our Voices series by hearing from Aman Quadri as he shares a story about how God found a Muslim boy. Let's dive in.
Think about it. We are near higher down in the heart or in the sky above. Without in this whole world, what is fair? We walk the line, try to see, falling behind on what could be. Oh, bring me a higher. Bring me a higher.
Well, hello, Gateway. It's nice to walk into some hype music. So I really appreciate what the production staff and the video team and even the worship team does every Sunday. So we're thankful for that. Well, for those that have not met me and I have not met, my name is Aman Quadri. It's really good to be here today. The last time I think I was on this stage was in 2006. I think I was invited to a panel on ethnic diversity. And the funny thing is the more things change, the more things stay the same, but that's a topic for a different message. But back then, we were also one campus. So it's really cool to be able to give a shout out to those watching online from my home campus, which is South, to Butte Kyle, to Pflugerville, to Dripping Springs, to Central, to Online, to Branson, to Zimbabwe, to Nicaragua, wherever you are, welcome. The Voices series is a unique time where we bring in well-renowned authors. I am not one of those. We bring in well-traveled and seasoned speakers. I am not one of those. We even bring in pastors from other churches to tell us about topics that are important to us. But as you guessed, I am not one of those. In fact, when I had a conversation with my family about being participating in this Voices series, the first thing they said is, whoa, you're not thinking about becoming a pastor, are you? And I was like, well, no. And they're like, okay, good. Keep on. Go ahead and do whatever you want to do. You see, in the end, who I am is you. Somebody who's been going to this church for some time. Who has a story that has been commingling with God's story long before I even knew it. So let me ask you a question this morning. What would happen to those around you if they knew your whole story? Now, I don't mean the facade we put on. I'm pretty good about this too. I mean everything, your triumphs, your tragedies, your addictions, the abuse, the cheating, the lies, the scandals. And better yet, what would happen if you let God into this story in every way, fully? What if I told you that each of you has a story that God can and will use to change others? Would you believe me? You see, I think in today's day and age of social media, we start looking around for other people's stories. What are they working on when we don't even realize we're living our own adventure? I and you both have stories that God can use in amazing ways. Now, let me be honest here. I don't really come on this stage willingly, so to speak. Really, I have this big fear, and let me tell you what it is. I have a fear that I don't know how you're going to feel about me once you know all of me. You see, each of us lives our story, you know, with peaks and valleys. Some are higher than lowers than others. I admit that. But what I want you to get today is something really simple. Your story matters, especially to God, and He can use it in amazing ways. Now, when praying for this message, I was trying to find a passage, you know, that could anchor this, that could become the foundation for this talk. And although I don't use this translation very often or often at all, it came in the message. And it comes from 2 Samuel 22:25 that states, God rewrote the text of my life when I opened the book of my heart to His eyes. You see, you too can rewrite your story by letting God fully into it, your whole story. And I hope you'll see that as I share mine. You see, I originally moved to Austin for graduate school about 20 plus years ago after spending some time in undergrad and running a small computer store in Southeast Texas. But I spent the first 10 years of my life fully devoted to physical therapy. That's where I did my graduate degree in. But over the last 5 years, I started beginning to get this itch to do something different. And so I started combining healthcare and tech in different ways. And so when you start working, you know, on different strategies around, you know, healthcare and technology, people start asking you to participate in certain events. And so I would go and I was presenting, and then I started becoming part of panels and then doing keynote presentations. And that's when God started working on me. You see, he started to say to me, or nudge me in my heart, every time I do a presentation, what about speaking for me? Now, usually I would blow it off and say, I don't know what you're talking about. But deep down I knew, and I was doing everything I could to avoid it. You see, in the business world, it's easy. When somebody comes to you and says, hey, Aman, could you fill out these TPS reports? And I'm like, well, hey, Bob, you know, let me think about it and I'll get back to you. You know, so that's what I was trying to do, to brush it off. Now, in the spiritual church world, it's a little bit more difficult. Like somebody comes up to me and says, hey, Aman, what about volunteering this Sunday? Like, well, hey, Bob, let me pray about it and I'll get back to you. And so that's what I was trying to do. See, my fear was compelling me to stay silent. And although I don't recommend it, I asked God to do a couple of different things. I said, look, God, if you really want me to participate, if you really want me to speak for you, you're going to have to give me some obvious signs, right? Some concrete signs that this is what you want me to do. And I think there were some subtle signs along the way that I brushed off, but he gave me two signs in a span of 2 days that I could not ignore. You see, the first one came in January. As it's probably been stated, I sit on the board of this church. And in this January meeting, I was one of the last people to leave. And at that meeting were John Burke and Eric Bryan. And they said, hey, can you hang back? Can we talk to you for a second? I said, sure. And John said, hey, I sent you a text message. And I'm like, well, I didn't receive a text message. And he said, no, I really did. I said, all right. I looked for it. I couldn't find it. But in the end, they were trying to say, hey, look, we think you should participate in the Voices series. And, you know, and I started thinking about it. And I said, hey, well, God's been putting it on my heart that he wants me to speak for him. And John said, hey, that text message is a sign. And I said, well, I didn't get that text message, so maybe that's a sign. But in the end, what I looked at, I said to John, I said, let me do something for you. Let me pray about it, and I'll get back to you. Now, the second sign was more obvious, right? So a week prior was my birthday, and my oldest daughter, my 12-year-old daughter, did something peculiar. She wrote me a pretty extensive note and said I should put it in a place where I could see it daily. So I put it on my dresser. Now, feeling a little guilty from doing the let me pray about it brush off to John and Eric, I actually decided to really pray that night and into that evening. And although I'd put that, you know, that note on a stand, the Holy Spirit started nudging me and saying, read the note. Now, I wasn't reading it regularly. Sorry about that, Alina. But I decided to pick it up. And this is what it said. It said, your voice is your masterpiece. Do not be afraid to use it. And so with that sign in hand, I picked up my phone, texted John and Eric, one word, okay. Before we really dive into my story, I want to tell you something. It is not easy for a Muslim who changes faith to really be open about it. You see, I am and technically labeled an apostate, and that's a person that, you know, converts from one religion to another. And in certain Islamic countries, that brings significant shame not only upon your family, but it also could lead to repercussions of death without any recourse to the family that does it. So thankfully, I was born and raised in this country, and that affords me freedoms that other people do not have. So, and that's the reason why so many people hide their faith change. So I believe that not sharing my story is a disservice for their bravery and courage. And so my way of honoring them is to not only tell you about my faith in Jesus, all right? So to honor those people that cannot share, but also this story, which I've kind of kept locked away for the last 20 years or so, as long as I've been at Gateway. Now, I grew up in Southeast Texas in a small town called Port Arthur. And it was relatively diverse. There were Hispanics, Blacks, Southeast Asians, South Asians, but I didn't go to school there. I went to school in a town called Nederland, which was across the highway. Now, for whatever diversity Port Arthur had, Nederland had none of it, right? And here is where I began to learn about myself, what made me different in both race and religion. Now, over the years, I began to realize that I really wasn't a great advocate for my own religion because I didn't understand it. And so my parents would bring in my grandparents. They would come to stay for extended periods of time. They would come down from Pakistan, and they would teach us to read and write Urdu, which is the predominant language there. They would also teach us to read Arabic, which is the language of the Quran. And from here is where I began to understand what we believed as Muslims. And some of you may have heard the five pillars of Islam, which are things like charity, praying five times a day, claiming that Allah is the supreme being and Muhammad is his prophet, right? You know, to fast in the month of Ramadan and the holy pilgrimage when you're old enough. Now, we also memorize verses from the Quran, and these are what you use during your daily prayers. And we always want to memorize the shortest ones because that means the prayers go by faster, right? And so what also ended up happening is our parents never pushed us to memorize the entire Quran. And those people are called Hafiz. They memorize from word for word the entire Quran. Now imagine if you were trained to memorize the entire Bible from start to finish, Genesis to Revelation. I mean, that would be an amazing accomplishment in itself. But think about this. What if you memorize the entire Bible in Hebrew or Greek, but never were taught to translate it into English? That's how millions of Muslims live, because we're taught the language of the Quran, which is Arabic, but we're not taught to translate it into something that becomes relational to us. So here I was. I had the three layers that I built my foundation of faith off of. The five pillars of Islam, the hadith, which are the acts or sayings attributed to the Prophet Muhammad, and the six articles of faith, one of which was important to me. And those are the books of which God is the author of. That would include four, right? The Torah, the Quran, the Psalms, and the Gospels. Now, growing up in elementary and middle school, I was one of the few kids that were either Pakistani or Islamic or Muslim. And so they would ask me to come and participate and share my stories. And so I was always happy to be a representative, of my culture and religion. Now, it's around this time that I had my run-in with Chuck Norris. Now, not that Chuck Norris, although that would be pretty awesome. And I've grown up with a lot of Chuck Norris jokes over the years. Most of them aren't safe for church, but I'll lay one on you this morning. How about this one? When God said, "Let there be light," Chuck said, "Say please." That is the power of Chuck Norris. Now, I didn't know this kid, all right? But he liked to show off his karate moves. And one morning, he showed off this roundhouse kick that was unbelievable. And when you can do things like that, you get the nickname of Chuck Norris. But there was something different about him. And one morning, he and I are standing at the bus stop. I don't know why we were by ourselves. My brother wasn't there. But we were alone, Chuck and I. And although we didn't speak regularly, he said something to me. He said, "Can I ask you a question?" I said, "Sure." "Yes, so?" And he said, "Do you know who Jesus is?" And I said, "Yes, I do. You see, as a Muslim, Jesus is the most mentioned prophet in the Quran. We believe that Jesus was a prophet and a man, nothing more than that. To think that God would have a son is a blasphemous idea. To think that he bore a son was even a more abhorrent idea. We also believe that Jesus didn't die on the cross, that he was raised up by Allah and brought to him, and another person was put in his place. But because he is a man, he has to come down to face death, so there's a second coming of Jesus as well." So I answered, "Yes, I do," Chuck said. He said, "I don't think so. You see, if you want a relationship with God, you have to take Jesus into your heart, and it's easy to do. When you go home tonight, kneel at the bedside, ask Jesus to come live in you, take him as your Lord and Savior. If you do that, that's all you have to do." See, that night, I don't know why, I was trying to find something underneath my bed, and when I got up, I was in this kneeling position. I remembered Chuck making that statement. I think scoffingly I said, like, "Oh, Jesus, if you're really real, come live in my heart and show me what this is really like." You see, in Jeremiah 1:7-9, it states, "But the Lord said to me, 'Do not say, I am too young. You must go to everyone I send you to and say whatever I command you. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you and will rescue you,' declares the Lord. Then the Lord reached out his hand and touched my mouth and said to me, 'I have put my words in your mouth.'" God would use his voice to speak to me. But I never saw Chuck again. Now, fast forward to middle school. See, we didn't visit family very often in Pakistan. And when we did, it was for extended periods of time, mostly because of the time issues of traveling there and the expense of it. When we did go, it was like 2 or 3 months, usually the summer. Now, while in middle school, we had the opportunity to go back for my uncle's wedding. Now, if you've ever been to an Indian or Pakistani wedding, let me tell you something. These are spectacles. They last 1, 2, 3 weeks. Nothing starts on time. Nothing ends on time. But there's food and dancing, and they go on forever. Now, the main part of the ceremonial event is when the groom goes to the bride's family home, and he brings her back to his house to start their life together. This is the uncle's home I was staying. And he had done a masterful job in his room of setting aside this bed. And there was When you have these matrimonial beds, there's petals of flowers everywhere. There's long strings of roses that are hanging all around the perimeter of the bed. Now, families come from all over, right? They're coming to stay because they're celebrating. And these homes are not small. They're big. There are multiple families living in it. There are beds everywhere, cots on the rooftop. You're spending time and sleeping in the, you know, on the roof to get, you know, catch a breeze. But at this night, I didn't have a place to sleep. And so my uncle offered me his bed. And that's the night my story changed. You see, this night, this uncle sexually assaulted me. You see, the man who would bring his bride home the next night and sleep in that matrimonial bed assaulted a young boy and changed my life forever. I don't remember much from it, bits and pieces mostly. I do remember waking up the next morning and him not being there. I was confused. I didn't know what to do. I tried to make sense of it all and then felt guilty for being there. I didn't want to tell my family. I didn't know why. I didn't. I chose internal silence. And that was a mistake. You see, I took my story and locked it up in a prison of shame and condemnation so I could pretend to be the same to the external world. It took a long time for me to figure out what had happened. But over those years, I internalized it. I became angry and depressed about it. And I questioned who I was as a person. I can tell you something, that when you start believing that narrative, the enemy sure loves to lock you in a prison of lies. I couldn't tell my family. I felt like I needed to protect them. Plus, I didn't know if they would actually believe me or not. And so I kept it to myself. I also felt I could be rejected by them for saying that or what shame would come. But more than anything, I felt like it was my fault. And I lived with that shame for a long time. But even though I lived within it, it wasn't my fault. And if you're out there and you've dealt with the same thing, I'm going to tell you something. It isn't your fault either. See, the enemy likes to whisper this to every man and woman who's been abused, that it's your fault and be silent. And the numbers are staggering. It's 1 out of every 3 women and 1 out of every 4 men in today's day and age. But I'm going to implore you, do not be afraid. God is with you. Bring your story to the light. Ask him to unchain it. Let it be heard and let it be healed. God can heal your story and use that story to heal others. In the end, I never saw this uncle again. And I tell you, I struggled coming home, but I knew how to hide it well as a kid. Behind good grades and friendships lay a kid that was struggling with identity. As I began to explore my faith more, and with increased access to the internet, I tried to find out the answers to the questions. I had to solve this myself. In the end, mustering enough courage, I began to seek counsel from chat rooms and bulletin boards. And bulletin boards are kids, they're not stuff on the wall, all right? Think of bulletin boards as like barbaric Facebook or the Atari of social media. But what it did is allow me to remain anonymous, like it happens today. I talked to people in chat rooms, unfortunately was introduced to porn to self-medicate, and even made my way into rooms that allowed me to learn about religion, including my own. Eventually, a user I chatted with said that I should visit an imam, a spiritual leader of the mosque. Now, I didn't go to the mosque very regularly, but there was one in driving distance, and I felt because of my infrequent attendance that it would remain anonymous in some form or fashion. I needed to fill a missing piece in my life, and I wanted to fix this myself. So I mustered the courage, and I went there and visited him. And I asked the normal questions. Why do bad things happen to good people? What happens to people that sin? Are there levels of sin? Can people be redeemed? I think that no matter where you are in the world, no matter what religion or if you are even religious, these are the questions that we ask. You see, his response destroyed me. See, when I laid down the happenings of what happened that night, his tone changed. Instead of leaning forward, he pulled away. He recited some verse from the Quran. I couldn't translate it, so I don't even know what it meant. And then he started asking me questions. Was I praying five times a day? Was I reading the Quran? Was I being a good son to my parents? Was I following all the tenets of Islam? And honestly, I didn't have good answers for any of it. I think after a while he studied me and he made a statement, and I'm going to paraphrase this today, but I'm going to lay a disclaimer here too. Not all imams think like this. I have met so many in my journey that have condemned his words and action, but this is what I heard and believed. You see, he said, sometimes Allah punishes those in this world that have disappointed him. And that as being not a true follower of Islam, not being a true son of my parents, that it was a reminder, this punishment, what happened to me, that he can strike me down not only in this life, but beyond, even after I die. To be told that what happened to me was the result of my sinful nature is like a dagger. See, why do bad things happen to good people? Well, they happen because I wasn't a good person. That's what I heard. You see, in this moment, I felt like Allah was rejecting me. I wasn't good enough to be a follower of Islam. I wasn't good enough to be a son of my parents. I wasn't good enough. And to be told that is devastating. To think that you have no worth in this world is a really bad place to be. See, why didn't Allah love me and punish the predator? Maybe it was just my fault. See, I didn't know what that's what Jesus came for. To set all people free from guilt, shame, and condemnation. Romans 8 says, there is no condemnation for those who belong to Christ Jesus. And because you belong to him, the power of the life-giving spirit has freed you from the power of sin that leads to death. But I didn't know this. So I was dying inside. And by the way, you don't have to be Muslim to receive bad religious advice. Maybe in your pain and anguish, people have said words that have pushed you away from God. That is not his way. That is what evil does. His damage done. I never saw that imam again. Man, I struggled for years. And I think my reaction was pretty typical from somebody going from high school to college. I rebelled. In the Hadith, it was written that no matter how good or bad you do, you're still at the whim of Allah whether you make it to heaven or not. So I made the weirdest decision of my life. I decided, if, as his mom said, I'm a sinful guy, and if I'm already going to hell, I might as well enjoy it. So I made this mental checklist of doing things like sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Well, let me pull that back. It was country music because I lived in Southeast Texas. Let me pull that back. But here's the thing. Nothing brought me solace. Nothing brought me peace. My parents ingrained in me a sense of right and wrong. My creator had ingrained in me a sense of right and wrong. So the alcohol, I tried it one time. Damn, that's nasty stuff. I even tried drugs. It didn't even do anything for me. Sex, it was not only not meaningful, but it didn't do anything for me and cost me more issues. I even started trying to eat other foods that were kind of against our religious or cultural beliefs. I tried things like yellow jello. I tried things like a Big Mac for my first hamburger for the first time. How do you even call that real food? I even started dating, which is another cultural no-no. See, dating as an older high school or college person should be its own form of punishment. But in that rebellion, it led me to a relationship with a true Christ follower. I saw religion from the eyes of somebody who wanted to know Christ and knew it and had a relationship with him. You see, I want to stress the word relationship because I didn't have that. She and her parents used their voices to tell me about Jesus. Now, here's some funny things. We were in a show choir together, and before you ask, yes, there were jazz hands in it. And at one point, I even had this notion of becoming a singer, not just any singer. I wanted to be a country music star. Now, I would eventually name my band The Cowboy and the Indian. Get it? It works, right? It works, right? And I would be the first Southeast Asian country singer on the Billboard Top 100. My friends even had a nickname for me. They used to call me Dark Brooks, because I could sing a mean Garth Brooks and lay down George Strait like nobody's business. Now, here's the thing. Those dreams pass, and those adventures are a totally different message in itself. But what I'm getting to is that I was using all those things to hide my pain and anguish. And when you feel worthless, sometimes you act worthless. Is that you? Do you use things like alcohol or drugs or partying or sexual activities or other forms of indulgences to hide your pain and anguish? It doesn't have to be that way. A new life is available through you, and I was about to find that out in a really unique way. Now, over the next couple of years, I started exploring my faith heavily, and that includes both Islam and Christianity. Now, my relationship started to solidify in and out of college, but my depression and anxiety hung over me. And I wanted to plug those holes, but I had to do it myself. And I knew I couldn't do it in my own hometown. It's too small. And so at this time, I'm traveling back and forth to Houston, about 2 hours away, as I'm studying for my MCATs, which is to go to medical school. Imagine that, a Pakistani guy going to medical school. But here's what happened. I ended up finding a doctor, who I'm going to name Dr. B, to work through these issues. Now, I met Dr. B for 6 sessions, and each one progressed into working through what happened, my frustrations, my inner conflict, my relationship challenges. And in the end, it centered on a couple of things. One, why I couldn't go to my family to tell them what happened, and they came down because I wanted to protect them. And two, why my creator never showed up for me when I needed him the most. At the end of my last session, Dr. B said that I was defensive and I needed to clear something inside of me where I could never let my guard down. She said you needed to bring it to him. As we were at the end of our patient-client relationship, she expressed to me her faith in God and how when she laid everything in front of him, that her life changed. Now, as I drove home from Houston to Nederland, I had nearly 2 hours to try, and so I thought, all right, let me see if I can do this. And I think I understood Dr. B when she said lay it in front of him. I thought of it, lay into him, and I gave it to him. I mean, I was angry. I yelled and screamed, and I said things like, why would you do this to me? Why weren't you there for me? Why did you stand by and not act on behalf? Why don't you love me? And for the first time in my life, I felt like I heard an audible voice. Pull over. I'm thinking to myself, this has got to be in my head. Pull over. And I'm thinking, are you talking to me? Are you now going to show up? Pull over. And I did, into a Whataburger parking lot. I said, okay, God, I'm here. What is it you want to show me? And he said, the answers to your questions. You're ready to see. In a flash, he brought me back to that moment of that night. And he showed me something I never saw or remembered. During the midst of this assault, and I don't know why, I uttered a phrase, help me, Jesus. And just like that, the phone on the bedstand, the nightstand rang. And his uncle stopped and he picked it up. And it was silence. No words from him. I don't think I could hear words on the other line. But he put the phone down, rolled over, and never touched me again. That night, when I woke up, he wasn't there. Jesus said, when you asked me for your help, for my help, I was there. He said, I've been there the day that you knelt on that bedside and prayed that I come in your heart. I was there. He said, in your hurt and anguish, I was there. He said, you've been trying to deal with this pain for so long. Stop. I am here. I don't know how long I cried in that parking lot. Mostly angry at myself for being in the way. But I gotta tell you something. After some time,
I realized there was another reason God had brought me there. He wanted me to understand that you could actually have a good fast food hamburger. So I had my first Whataburger that night too. You see, no matter where you are in life, God is with you. And Jesus said it this way, look. In Revelations, he says, look, I stand at the door and knock. If you hear my voice and open the door, I will come in. He is waiting at the doorstep. And he said, I will come in and we will share a meal together as friends. In my case, Whataburger. He is waiting at the doorstep of our lives and your heart too. Let him in. I thought he was distant throughout the years and I didn't want to have any part of him. What I didn't realize is that Jesus didn't want to be apart from me or you. In the end, I never saw Dr. B again. Man, now I'm driving home. A sense of dread is both lifted and lies on me. I'm talking to God as a friend in a passenger seat. And I'm finally like, God, what is it you want from me? And he says, I want you to profess your faith and follow me. And so I did, knowing full well that I had to lead two lives, one for my family and one for God for now, because I couldn't tell my family what had happened. It would devastate them and bring shame upon them. And so there, driving home, I said, Lord, I give myself to you. I take you as Lord the Savior. And for some reason, I felt like that wasn't enough. And God spoke to me and said, I want you to profess it publicly. I said, Lord, I am not there yet. We just got this relationship going, so why don't we slow down a bit? But he kept on saying it. I want you to profess it publicly. And so for the first time, I asked for the signs. I said, God, if you really want me to do this, you're going to have to make these signs pretty darn obvious. And that's when the first sign appeared. Oh, I mean a literal billboard appeared. It said revival up ahead. And I'm like, oh no, we are not going there. And the next billboard came up, literally, confess your sins. And I'm like, you have to be kidding me, Lord. And the next billboard, I kid you not, profess your faith. And I'm like, thinking in my head, these are little billboards. What is your advertising budget right now, God? But the last billboard shows up, pull over now before it's too late. So I pull over into a tent revival. And I want you to imagine for a moment what a tent revival would be like. Yep, it probably was there. Here I am walking into a circus tent, stepping inside of this, a Pakistani Muslim walking into a Southeast Texas tent revival, and all eyes are on me, like, whoa, right there. And I'm like, hey, how you doing? Whatever. The pastor is calling forth people saying, come forward, you know, profess your faith. And I'm walking in. I'm like, hey, how's it going? You know, that's all good stuff. And he's like, why are you here? And I'm like, well, I feel like God has asked me to profess myself publicly. And then all of a sudden it's hallelujah. The you know, singing, dancing, chanting. I don't know. I think there was a snake there. I have no idea. All I remember is God laughing in the background in my head saying, you asked for a sign. And since then, the one constant, the one person that has never disappeared from my life is Jesus. Now, have I failed him? More often than I would admit this morning on stage. But I got to tell you, he remains for me just as he remains for you. You see, from this point on, I had to make a choice over the next several years. Would I follow him? And what would my first love would be? You see, Matthew 10 reads, anyone who loves their father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. Anyone who loves their son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Whoever does not take up their cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Man, I have really disliked this passage over the years. I think many people read this in Matthew and gloss right over it because it doesn't pertain to them. But I had to make a decision. Do I follow family or God? I love my family more than I tell them and more than they realize. But until I make my first love and faithfulness to God, I am not truly loving my family. You see, I chose to try to please them. I chose to try to follow that path. And in the end, that makes them an idol. putting them before God is not good for me. It's not good for them. But it comes with significant consequences. I have faced rejection by them, being disowned by them, brought back by them, being kept away from certain events because they didn't want people to know my faith change. See, I have to take the love that Christ has for me and emulate that to them, no matter what, if they accept or reject me. I can tell you this, friends, following God is not easy. Using your voice may make you lose friends, family, or even things that you consider dear. You may have to make some tough decisions and step out in ways you never thought possible, but are you willing to make God first? Are you willing to let God in fully, in every way? And then let him use your voice to heal others? He is there at the door of your heart knocking. Will you let him in? You let him in if you've never let him in at all? Will you let him in into the deep, dark, shameful places that you try to hide from others? Let him in. Let him use your voice. Let him use your story. And let him set you free. A 12-year-old wise person once wrote to me, "Your voice is your masterpiece. Do not be afraid to use it." Will you pray with me? Dear God, thank you for this morning. Thank you for this day. Thank you for this week, Lord. I pray that those out there listening understand that if they've been through circumstances beyond their control, that they can come to you, Lord. They can open their hearts to you, Lord. They can bring their hurts. They can bring their triumphs. They can bring everything and lay it in front of you, Lord. Lord, I pray that they understand that their voices, their stories matter to you, and you can use it not only to heal them, but to heal others. Let them realize that one day their story and their voice may become the survival guide for somebody else. Lord, we lift all this stuff up to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I'm so grateful that Aman would share his story with us. But what's your story? Throughout your life, God has been pursuing you, has been with you, even if you did not realize that. I don't want you to close your laptop or look away from the screen. I want you to focus in this moment on those times in your life where God was there for you, even if you didn't realize that. Think about that as we listen to this. Thank you.
words I hear you say. You've been speaking out for all of time. All of time. The words I hear you say. You've been speaking out for all of time. All of time. The words I hear you say. You've been speaking out of time, and you gave me, and you called me, and you have played on me, and I've never walked alone, and you gave me, and you called me, and you have do me, let my heart be awakened by the whispering of love. Be close to your heart.
As my daughter was singing that song, I just was reminded of how much God was with us, even in the moments we didn't realize it. Aman shared his story, but he didn't share the part of the story that involves this community. He's been a part of Gateway for 20 years. He's now serving on the board with us. He met his wife here, and they've raised their children here. And he will tell you that transformation comes in the context of community. You and I, we need community.